So now that you know the functions of these individual enzymes from the last lecture, let's talk about putting it all together and what it looks like when DNA replicates. Okay. So there are two major requirements for replication, one of which is going to be an ample supply of nucleotides. In other words, we've got to have adenines to pair with existing thymines and cytosines to pair with existing guanines. We're going to use those normal DNA pairing rules, okay, where A pairs with T and C pairs with G, okay, and what's called a primer template junction. Okay. In other words, there has to be a place, okay, for an RNA primer to actually lay down on the DNA. Now, this is a requirement because if you remember, that DNA polymerase cannot just add to a single strand of DNA. Okay? You have to have a primer, there has to be a double-stranded start. Then the DNA polymerase can come in and start adding on corresponding nucleotides. So each single strand of DNA will be a template, so we're actually going to do this in duplicate once for each side of the single-stranded DNA. Okay. And that short piece of RNA is brought in by something called primase. Okay. So the primer is brought in by a primase. Okay. Usually ends up looking something similar to this. Now I'm going to move to a blank screen. Okay. And we're going to add in, right, as we go. Now, if you remember, the DNA is super coiled together, right, inside of the bacteria in that nucleoid region. Right? Step one is going to be to get rid of this. This is a jumbled mess. Right? So the enzyme topoisomerase, right, is actually going to come in and help us unsupercoil the DNA, okay, to get it nice and sort of flattened out to make it easier to read. This is like crumpled up paper. This is paper that's flattened out. Okay. Now, the next step is going to be to separate these individual strands. Okay. The strands have to be separated because this is where your template, okay, is going to exist. About this is where your template's going to get and to exist, and then separating these will actually allow access to them. The primase can come in and add the primer, right? The DNA polymerase can come in and add complementary nucleotides. This is done, okay, with an enzyme called DNA helicase, right? So helicase's job will be to unwrap, right, the DNA, to break it apart into two single-stranded individual pieces. Right? Now, what you end up with here, right, is something called a replication bubble. Right? And at either end of the replication bubble, where we go from double-stranded to single-stranded, these are known as replication fork. So this is a replication fork, and this is a replication fork as well. If you're not doing it at home, draw this with me. Okay. So I'm going to get a new blank screen up, and we're going to make this a little bit bigger. Okay. All right. So I have our large replication bubble. Right. So your entire replication bubble, right? Now remember, these are complementary strands of DNA and they run anti-parallel to one another. So while one goes in this particular direction, the other moves in that direction. Okay. So if you also remember, okay, in each strand of DNA, there will be an origin of replication, a starting point. Okay. Now, at the origin of replication, we will actually see. That primase come in and lay down a short RNA primer. Okay? So this is primase, the enzyme. And what happens up there will also happen down here, just in the opposite direction. Okay? Now, once the primer is there, oh, there's an easier way to switch between these ink colors. Okay. Once the primer is there, okay, then what we see is that, okay, DNA polymerase can come in and add nucleotides, complementary nucleotides, okay, to turn this single-stranded DNA in the red into double-stranded DNA in the orange, okay? And again, the same thing will happen over here. Okay. Now, the nice part about this is that as these individual pieces open up, as the helicase opens these pieces and makes them double-stranded, okay, what you'll see is that the DNA polymerase gets to continuously move along the strand and go down and go down and go down and go down. Okay. Now, the unfortunate part is that on the opposite side, okay, of this, in order to replicate these pieces, we've got to have primase come in and lay down another primer, and come in and lay down another primer, and lay down a primer, and lay down a primer, because that polymerase is only going to move, okay, in a single direction. Okay. So as the polymerase comes in, okay, see it moves in this direction, it moves in this direction. And it moves in this direction and moves in this direction. I'm going to add some videos of this on a D2L. Make sure you look at them. I can't make this move, obviously. If I could, it would be fantastic. But oftentimes, three-dimensional videos, okay, are actually great to watch. Okay. What happened to my screen? And what we see is that, okay, that strand that gets to continuously keep moving. I love this. This is your DNA polymerase in the shape of this little hand that continuously moves towards the replication fork is going to be known as the leading strand. This is what we consider continuous replication because as the fork opens, the polymerase gets to keep going and keep going and keep going. Okay? On the opposite strand, okay, we've laid down several blue, okay, RNA primers, and we have to keep going back in and adding in the individual pieces of DNA. So this strand is being discontinuously replicated, okay, and is known as the lagging strand, with each of those discontinuously replicated pieces being known as Okazaki fragments. Okay? So a discontinuously replicated piece is called an Okazaki fragment. Now, eventually, a new polymerase will come in, specifically DNA polymerase 1. Okay. So DNA polymerase 1, and we're working with DNA polymerase 3, okay, to add on all these nucleotides. So this is DNA polymerase 3. DNA polymerase 1 will come in and remove those primers. Okay. And replace them with strands of DNA because there is no RNA in our DNA. So those primers of RNA will be removed and pulled out and get replaced with DNA by polymerase 1. All of these small discontinuous pieces will be basically glued together with the help of an enzyme called DNA ligase. If you remember lig, it means to bind or attach. The DNA ligase is going to come in and actually attach, okay, all these individual Okazaki fragments to one another. Okay? And this continues and continues, okay, until the strands are completely replicated. You see these green origins here, right? Replication, both continuous and discontinuous, okay, happening along these strands. They continue all the way around until we reach a termination. Okay? Basically, the entire chromosome has been replicated, and topoisomerase actually comes back in and separates the two chromosomes from one another so that they're no longer attached. This ends replication. So, like I said earlier, check out that video, some of the replication videos that are on D2O. Okay. The next video, we're going to explore actually using the DNA not for replication purposes, so not to make another organism, because that's the only reason to replicate DNA is making another organism. Instead, we're going to talk about utilizing DNA as instructions for how to make proteins. So we're going to go through that central dogma on transcription and translation, turning DNA into RNA and then RNA into proteins.